Niklas Frank is a German writer, but best known for being the son of Hans Frank, the Nazi lawyer who was appointed by Hitler to be the Governor General of occupied Poland during World War II and who was directly responsible for the murder of millions of people. I met Niklas Frank and he told me about the way he has dealt with the awful legacy left by his father.
Niklas Frank, thank you for coming this morning. You are here at Brighton to give a talk, to participate in the Holocaust Memorial Day events at the University of Sussex, organized by the Center for German Jewish Studies. And this is something that you do a lot. You travel around and you tell the story about being the son of a Nazi leader, really. And I know that what I'm going to ask you, you've been asked before, and I know that what you will be asked today when you go to the university will be questions that you've heard before. And yet you're willing to do this again and again and go through the story, which must be a painful story. Why do you do that?
First of all, it depends on invitations. I don't calling everybody, please invite me. It depends.
Sure.
Somebody is showing up and invites me. And in England, very often I was invited by Jewish communities around England. It was always a pleasure to be there. For me, to do this is always because what I have in my heart and also in my brain are the victims of my father, who was responsible as the Governor General of occupied Poland for all the death camps.
And yet it was your father. You have your own life, but you're dedicating really your life to telling the story of your father, of your relationship with the whole concept.
No, I didn't dedicate my life to my father. And quite on the other hand, I always said to myself, already when I was very young, I will not let my father ruin my life. So I became a journalist, and very late, when I became nearly 50 years old, I started to open up and to write an awful book against my father and also against my mother, and then it started. But never my father had ruined my life. I was a journalist, which I liked very much.
So let's go back to the beginning. You were born in 1939, just before the war. And your father was hanged when you were about seven, after
seven,
the Nuremberg trials.
Yes.
What do you remember of your father, of the family life in the early years?
The most important scene for my life was, I was a very, very small child and was running around a big round table, longing to get into the arms of my father, but my father refused, saying to me, "What do you want? You are a stranger. You are not belonging to our family." And I was crying.
How old were you roughly when that happened?
I would say about 3 years, not older.
And you remember that?
Yes, because it burned into my soul. To be refused by one of your parents, it's really awful, and you only have two ways to become a psychologically spoken a wreck, or you can survive and become a little bit stronger. And
which is what
unfortunately
happened.
Fortunately it was the second way.
And your father said that you did not belong because he believed for a while that you weren't his biological son.
But the son of his best friend, Mr. Lush.
Right.
But later on, he acknowledged that I am his son.
That you were
his
son.
Because my mother was very furious.
Right. When was it that you felt that you needed to do something about this horrible legacy that you were left with?
It was always in me. Yesterday, when I left my home, my wife, which I knew since we were 22. He remind me that I always have said, once upon a time I will write about my father. So it was in me. And I used to ask all the relatives, all the official guys who survived the Third Reich, tell me about my father. That was always in me.
Going back to the beginning of our conversation, and I know that your book, the title of your book in German is about revenge. Wouldn't it be the sweetest revenge, really, if you thought, okay, I'm going to stop this now. I'm going to concentrate on my life. I don't want to be furious on a daily basis. My father doesn't deserve that.
Not my father. But still, in Germany, I'm afraid of the future of the Germans, because we have learned nothing out of this, those 12 years of Nazi regime. And this is the other thing. So what I am doing, if I am invited, is to tell them, please look at it. And it's not my father. On the other hand, I always also say, life is stronger. I don't like the Germans running around with sad eyes or with fists and being ashamed. Guilt is always something personal. You can't accuse a whole people. As also Mr. Jackson in his opening statement in the trial of Nuremberg said, we are not accusing the German people. And this is correct. So everybody in Germany has to deal with it. And what is lacking is to acknowledge the guilt, not to be ashamed. Maybe you can be, because you are by chance, you are a member of German people. You are not an American.
And it's another generation. Why should they feel the guilt?
No, they don't need to feel guilt. That makes you ashamed and with sad eyes. That's wrong. That doesn't work, because life is too strong.
Right.
They just should acknowledge it, what our ancestors have done.
And you feel that there's still not enough acknowledgement in Germany, do you? You really feel that?
Now, the speaker of our parliament 2 weeks ago said, now the anti-Semitism is growing. It was always there, but now they are loud, they have become stronger. Now they dare to be more open with anti-Semitism.
Not just in Germany, racism and anti-Semitism.
If it comes to German history, I don't compare with any other people. I don't care for other peoples. I just told, we are the Germans. We built up the most horrible death machinery in the world. So we have to deal, and we should know nowadays how to treat foreigners, how to treat migrants, and all this kind of thing. And this is not happening.
Did you, when you lived in Krakow, in that castle, did you get a chance to see?
No.
Never.
I was too small.
Right.
Not one Polish child I was friend of, or something like this. But my eldest siblings, Sigrid, the oldest one, and Norman, they went to German school in Krakow. And they knew, after my brother Norman has died, I interviewed some classmates of him. And they were telling me, we saw it all the time. They hanged Polish people, the poor Jewish people running around, begging for bread, something, when they had the permission to go outside of the Krakow ghetto, and later on plush of the concentration camp. And the ambience, that makes me feel furious.
But it's interesting, you just mentioned the word forgive. Some people who have experienced the Holocaust, some survivors, have decided to forgive, perhaps for their own well-being. This is not something that you would
it's
ever...
It's not my way. I can't forgive it. Because you'll see it again. The leader of the AfD, the right-wing new party, with big, many followers now, he said the following sentence, in the whole German wonderful history, those 12 years are nothing else than a bird's shit. Who is saying this? It's especially against the victims. That's unbelievable. And they didn't throw him out of the party. He is still the leader of the party. He still is invited to every talk show available in Germany. It's unbelievable. This makes me furious. And this always reminds me of my father.
Right.
My father could have seen this, and he knew exactly what he is doing. The most horrible crimes.
So do you think he was really brainwashed by the...
No, he wasn't brainwashed. No. He knew exactly. He knew exactly.
It's just impossible.
No way out. No way. And in the diary of his youth, not a single anti-Semitic sentence was found, but a lot of sentences against the French who were taking away our girls.
Right.
He wasn't anti-Semitic. If Hitler would have said the English people, for instance,
it
are the worms and the German Körper and so on, he would have said the same horrible sentences against the English.
So it was a blind following...
No blind. Not blind. He was a
careerist.
He wanted to please Hitler, he was in love with. My sister used to say he loved Hitler more than his own family. She was right, secret was it. So that is, he wasn't blind. He knew exactly till to the end.
When I say blind, I mean, you know, like we say someone is blinded by love. And you say, you know, if Hitler had said something against the French or the English or, you know, so, it's incredible, isn't it? It was, your father must have been an intelligent person.
He was one of the most educated Nazi big shots, for sure.
But didn't think as such if he just followed, according to you, if he just followed Hitler's, you know, ideas, rather than think for himself and perhaps reach different conclusions. Do you think it's really as simplistic as that? He followed what Hitler said because he loved Hitler?
No. On one way, yes. But he loved very much the castle, being, as Goebbels called him, the king of Poland, yes, behaving like this. Yes, he loved it very much. He was very much enthusiastic about his 110 uniforms. Yes.
110 uniforms.
Yeah. He loved this kind of prunk, as you call it in Germany, German. And this he liked very much. So he gave a shit about all the other people.
And you said before that his love for Hitler was more than just love for the ideas that Hitler presented. It was a personal, nearly homosexual love.
He was some kind of homosexuality. And also the psychologist in the Nuremberg prison, Mr. Gilbert, said or wrote later on that Mr. Frank was kind of homosexual. I would have liked if he could have lived his homosexuality. Maybe I wasn't fair then.
Hmm. And because your mother was not a member of the Nazi Party, do you know what she felt? I mean, I understand that she probably enjoyed the lifestyle.
Well, probably, for sure. She liked it very much. We didn't know our mother till to the end of the war. She was always away.
Doing what? She was away.
Doing what? She has her own car, her own chauffeur. He had a lot of money. He used to go during the war shopping in the ghettos, and she was unbelievable. She didn't care about the Jews, but from the very beginning of her life, she grew up in a very poor family, and she dealt with Jewish agencies taking furs into commission, selling. So she knew a lot of Jews. She never saved one of them. Never. My father admitted for a very short time, about half an hour, he admitted his personal guilt. Yes, and when he was in the stand or on the stand on the 18th of April in 1946. And all the letters which my mother, after this acknowledgement of his personal guilt, or of my other siblings who could write in the middle, nobody mentioned, "My dear father, it's wonderful that you admitted your guilt," or "my wife," my mother, yes.
Never did.
He surrounded this. And shortly after he was, I wasn't guilty. I was never a criminal.
So it was just a fleeting moment.
He wanted to impress the judges.
Right.
He refused me to get into his arms. It was really, I was really lucky. And also the second thing with his last lie to me. And the third one I didn't tell you. Father O'Connor handed over to us little prayer books, yes? And in this prayer book was a personal note from our father to each of his children. And he misspelled my name. Nicky always was written also in his other letters, N-I-K-I. And he wrote it with N-I-C-K-I. And as a child, you are really upset. So it's the last sign, he don't care, he give a shit of me. No, I can't forgive him, but that's not the important thing, that I will never, never, ever survive with the victims. It's always the victims. When I read the book of Mrs. Laskavar, it was unbelievable. What a German family.
Yes.
They had to speak French on Sundays. Everybody played an instrument. Unbelievable. German as German can be.
Yes.
And just because of Jewish. So stupid. So inhuman.
And I also read that you actually paid a little, you know, quite a lot of money to purchase the uniform, the jacket, the Nazi jacket of your father.
Coat. No. I got now about 5-6 years ago. I got an email from a lady I knew already. She is the grandniece of the Mr. Lieutenant Stein, a German Jew, who arrested my father. And he, maybe my mother gave it to him as a gift. They became friends.
Right.
It's very strange. And this Lieutenant Stein took this coat back home to the United States. And his grandniece offered in a mail, said, "My aunt has this coat. Are you interested in?" And I immediately had an idea. And I said, "Yes, I am interested in." And how much it will cost me. And he said $500. And I transferred those $500 and got this coat. And now it's my scapegrow.
Your scapegrow in the garden.
Great. And I see him from my living room. And that's the only thing you had deserved, being a scapegrow.
But that's an unusual reaction, isn't it?
It's a healthy one.
You find it healthy because you see him there every day. You see the coat.
Also, the coat wasn't there, I always was with him.
Right.
Insofar, that is also the last sentence in my book, is I'm still a puppet on the string, and the string has my father.
But going back to the question I ask all the time.
Sorry.
He's not, you don't feel that if you cut the strings yourself, you will be free in some way?
I am free. I am the most ridiculous grandfather you can imagine. I was a heavy, tricky tennis player. Most of my articles have nothing to do with information, but just fun. I wrote also other books about quite another stuff. But you have something special in you. You you grew up in a family where the father was hanged. That is special, because you can't compare it with all the other families where the fathers maybe had been killed in, during the war, something like that, or died of cancer. He got a trial 1 year long and was hanged. That's special. Everybody, all the five children had to deal with it. And so that is what always is in you.
And you feel it's your responsibility to share that?
Responsibility is such a high work. If I am invited, I am telling, and I always be very honest, because my father was the biggest liar. And I also can lie if it comes to it. That is an inheritance of my father. But knowing my father, I try really never to lie.
Right. So in some way, you have found something good to, you know, to...
Yes, fighting against my father is always good. Was in this talent.
Niklas Frank, thank you so much.
Was a pleasure.
Goodbye.